Okay, so let's start. So the first thing we need to do, or that we usually do at the beginning, is to load our packages. And what I usually always do at the start of each script is that I remove my entire working environment, because I really don't like it if I have some variables left over from another script, and then I get confused because I sometimes name them in the same way, and then I don't know which variable is which. So I usually start with a very clean environment, and then I load the packages that we need. And the packages that we need for this tutorial is a raster package, the caret package, map view package. It's not actually necessary for the machine learning algorithms, but it's nice for some data visualizations. And I just changed my script that I'm using SFSOL just in the last minute. Okay, so far, everyone happy? I think you downloaded all the packages already, so that should work, okay? Good, then we have two data sets that we need for the tutorial. And one data set is called Sentinel 2017. It's a raster data set. And the second one is a shapefile called training sites. So we're going to read these two data sets. And now we just imported two data sets, but we don't have any idea about what these data sets include so far. So the first thing that we usually do is we print these data so that we can get an impression about what data we're working with. So I start printing here the Sentinel data. And what we see is that our Sentinel object is a raster stack. Tim already talked a bit about raster stacks, but is it clear to everyone what a raster stack actually is? Who knows what a raster stack is? Most important point is that so we have a raster data set, but it's not only one raster layer, but we have several raster layers. So that's why we call it a stack, because we have several raster layers that have similar properties, so same resolution and same extent, same coordinate reference system, but they have different information. And usually the different information when we have satellite data are several bands of the satellite data set. So as you saw from the name of the data that we imported, so it was called Sentinel, and Sentinel is a quite new satellite system. I think it exists since 2014. And from Sentinel, we get several bands that give us a reflectance of the land surface in different wavelengths. So we have some bands that give us a reflectance in the visible, but also some bands that give us a reflectance of the land surface in the near infrared and so on. And all these different information are stacked together, because each information is a separate band in this data set. Okay, what information do we get from printing the information of the Sentinel data? So we see it's a raster stack. We get the dimensions, so the number of rows and the number of columns, and that in total gives the number of cells that we have in the data set. And we see that we have 10 layers. So our raster stack consists of 10 different single raster layers. And the resolution is 10 by 10. Now the main question is, what is 10 by 10? So what do you think, what is the unit of 10 by 10 when we're talking about that raster data set? Any ideas? Yeah, exactly. Exactly, so that depends on a coordinate reference system, because the resolution is always given in the unit of the coordinate reference system, and we're working here in UTM coordinate reference system, and we have the unit meter. So we have a spatial resolution of 10 by 10 meters, so each pixel in this raster data set is 10 by 10 meters. Okay. Yeah, but it's nice to get a first impression by printing the information, but usually we can only get a proper impression about what this data set really includes if we print the data set, if we plot the data set. And we can simply do it by using plot. And you see it takes a while because we have quite a few raster layers in this data set. So here we see that we have not only one raster layer, but we have band 2, band 3, band 4, band 8, band 5, band 6, and so on and so on. So different raster layers. And to get an idea about what these raster layers stand for, we can go to Wikipedia and just Google search for Sentinel-2, and here we get the information what the bands stand for. So we have band 2 is a reflectance in the blue, band 3 is a green, band 4 is red, and then we have some red edge and some near-infrared bands. So that's the coding for the different bands here. And what we also have is an additional band called NDVI. The NDVI is a an index that is based on the ratio between the reflectance in the red light and in the near-infrared, and is a frequently used index for vegetation studies. And there's another artificial band in there, which is the yellowness, and the yellowness is also an index that was calculated based on the ratio between the reflectance in the blue and green light compared to reflectance in the red. Which gives us an indication about how strong the yellowness of a certain pixel is. So these are the information that are stacked here together in this data set called Sentinel. And to get even a better impression, because this is not really nice if we look at each band here individually, we can use a view RGB function that Tim presented earlier on, and I hope I'm using it in the right way. So when we do this, we should get, after some time, and some more time, finally. So we get a true color composite of the data set. And we get here the information from MapView that the resolution of the raster was reduced for plotting because the raster is probably too big or to visualize it in a speed that is acceptable. So it was reduced here. So what we see is actually not the true resolution of the data set. So it's actually a bit better than we see it here. This extent here is the extent of the Sentinel data set we're going to work with. And what I plotted in addition is the shapefile called training sites. And the training sites are these polygons here. And I digitized these polygons using QGIS. I probably could have also used MapEdit, but I'm not that much up to date. So I used QGIS to do this. What I did is I went through the composite, through the image composite, and I was looking for areas where I was quite sure what land cover they belong to. So I zoomed in and I saw this yellow part that we see here is typical gorse, which is an invasive plant that we're actually aiming to map because New Zealand has quite a big problem with invasive plant species, and gorse is one of them, and you can actually see that it covers whole slopes of this Banks Peninsula, which is our training or our model domain here. So I was looking for parts where I was quite certain that we have gorse here. And the proper way, if you want to do it in a more scientific way, would of course be that you go out into the field with a GPS device and you really look for these locations where you can even make sure on the ground that this is the land cover you're talking about. Okay, so I got some polygons for gorse. I got some for, let's find another one. Forestry here, I got a water polygon, and I think some more water polygons, and some urban training samples, and some grasslands. So these are the training sites we're going to work on. Everything clear so far? Are you in the same speed as I am, or do you need some time? So all data, yeah? Okay, good. Okay. The next step that we need to do in order to prepare these data for the modeling, and maybe you remember from my talk yesterday, is that we want to create a nice table. So we need to somehow get these raster data together with the training sites into the format of a nice table, because this is how Carrot wants the input data to be prepared. And I think we used the extract function already earlier on today. So extract function is exactly what we need, because what extract is doing, it takes the raster data here and it looks for the locations of the polygons, and it actually really extracts all the pixels that are overlaid by this polygon and puts this into a data frame. So when I do this, it's quite slow. Okay, and I just look at the first few lines of this data set. I see that I get all my pixel values now in a format of a nice data frame. But what you can also see is that one important point is missing for the preparation of the model training. Do you remember which information is still, or which information might still be missing in this data frame so that we can use it as an input for model training? Yeah, exactly. The response is missing, so we don't have the information about which land cover class these pixel values belong to. And we can easily fix that by merging this data frame with a training data set. When we do this and look at the first lines again, what we see is that the class is added here as well. So we see that these pixel values here in the first line belong to a training site of the class Gauss. And of course, there are some more if you look at the end of this extraction table. Yeah, so now we are here in a class send, so there all the pixels from the training data set extracted in one table now. And if you have a look at the number of rows in this data set, we get quite a large, or average large data set of 11,000 training data points. So these are the data points we could train the model on now. But if we train the model on all these data sets, we don't have any training or any reference points left for the model validation, because and that's why the next step is that we split this data set into samples that we use for model training and for some samples that we use for the model validation. And we can do this by the nice function called createDataPartition from Carrot. And what's nice about this function is that we're not splitting our data set randomly, but we do it in a stratified way, and we do this here by looking for our response variable, the class. And what createDataPartition is then doing, it makes sure that the distribution of the classes is the same in each data partition. So this means that we have the same distribution of the class in our training data set and in the test data set later on. Because if you don't do that, there might be the risk that if we have a very small class, so a class that only covers maybe a few pixels, and we randomly split our data set, it might be that in either the training data or the validation data, there is no pixel from that class, so we can't make predictions for this class. So if you do this, we make sure that we keep all the classes and we can specify here how large our training data set should be. So I use 30% of the data table, and I could have used more, but it's also a matter of time, and because we don't want to spend the whole hour waiting for the random forest algorithm to finish the calculation, so I reduce this data set to a bit of a minimum, and I only use 30% of the data set for model training. The result that we get from create data partition is, if you have a look at that, just IDs. So we get the IDs or the row numbers of the data that are selected for the respective partition, and we can then use these IDs to split the data set. So we first split the data set into all those that include these IDs, and we use a test data set which is exactly the opposite. With this minus here, I indicate that we're going to use all rows from the data set that are not in the training data set. Okay, if I will look at the size now, we have the train dot with a size of 3,400 training points, and our test data has roughly 8,000 points that we can use for the model validation then. Good. So we're continuing, or we're going to continue now with the train data, and we leave the test data to the side, so we're not going to touch them now. They're therefore a proper external validation of the model data on. And basically what we could do now, so I've shown you yesterday in the presentation that we directly went from the training data table into model training, and we were not thinking about which variables we could use, which might be okay, but I think it's quite interesting that we first get an impression about how the variables that we have, the predictor variables that we have, actually relate to our response variable. And we can do this by, for example, first doing a box plot. So doing a box plot between the yellowness index and each of the land cover classes. So we can see here now, or what the aim is, that we can see how the different land cover classes differ in the yellowness. And if they differ a lot, there is a good chance that we get a high separability between the classes. And if all the land cover classes would have the same yellowness, then the yellowness might not be a variable that helps a lot in doing a land cover classification, because this variable is not suitable to distinguish the land cover classes. But we see here in the box plot that we have quite high differences between the classes, which is not surprising, is that the gorse has the highest yellowness, because the flowers of the gorse in spring are very, very yellow, and that's why they also appear here with a high values of yellowness, while water has a very low yellowness, which makes sense because it appears blue to us. And the other classes somehow range in between. Okay, so much just for the comparison of the yellowness. We could now also try it for other information. For example, we could use, what else do we have? The near infrared. And compare the near infrared for the different classes. And here we see that grassland has the highest ND, what did they use? Highest near infrared, which makes sense because usually dense vegetation has a high reflectance in the near infrared, and water again has nearly no reflectance in the near infrared at all. What is also interesting is that we have a difference, or that we have a look on how we can separate the classes if we look at two channels at the same time, or two bands at the same time. We can do this with a feature plot here. Yeah. Which is on the first sight a bit complicated, but it's actually not that complicated. So what we see here is how the different classes can be separated on the basis of two bands. So if you look, for example, on this plot over here, We have on the y-axis B8. B8 is the near infrared. And on the x-axis, we have the yellowness. So we see how we can separate the classes based on these bands. We see that here probably that's water. It's a bit not suitable that we have bear and water in the same color. But one of these classes can be distinguished from the other classes very, very clearly. So there's no overlap at all because this class has low reflectance in the near infrared and it has low reflectance at the yellowness at the same time. And the gauze here is shown in red, and the gauze has a high yellowness, and it has an average near-infrared, and these are properties that nearly no other class has, so all the other classes are in a different location of the scatter plot. So we see that with these two variables, for example, we have a good chance to distinguish between our classes. Well, if we have a look at this part of the feature plot, where we see on the x-axis the reflectance in, I think it's a green band, and on the y-axis we have the reflectance in a red band, and we see that there's not a good chance to distinguish between the classes. The only class that is different from the others is the green one here, which is sand, and that makes quite sense because sand, or especially white sand, has a quite high reflectance. So we see here also high reflectance in the red band and high reflectance in the green band as well. But just based on these two variables, we wouldn't have a good chance to split our classes because there's too much a mix of the classes, what we can see here. But in general, if you look at this, there's a good chance that we can make a land cover classification based on this data, because we have some variables that allow us to produce a good split in the data set. Okay. Questions so far? If not, we move on to the actual model training. Okay. The first point we need to do is we need to define which predictor variables we want to use. And usually, if we don't have any variables, which might be kind of a problem, yesterday we talked about coordinates or elevation or something like that, but we don't have anything like that here, so we only have quite continuous data from satellite information. So what I'm going to do is I am going to use all the bands that I have available and feed them into the machine learning algorithm. So I'm going to define here that I'm going to use all the spectral bands and the yellowness index and the NDVI as predictor variables for the model. And as response variable, I'm going to use the class. Let's see here, if we go into our train data, train dot, this is a column name of the column in our data set where the land cover class is included. So these two lines just for definition of which are our predictor variables and which is our response variable. Okay. Now we can then move on to the model training. If you want, you can set a seed. If we set a seed, we make sure that if we repeat the model training, we get the same results again, because if you don't do that, because most machine learning algorithms, especially here Random Forest, is not a deterministic algorithm, so we get slightly different results if you run the model again. And if you really want to make comparisons or want to make sure that you can get the same results again, you can set any seed. It doesn't matter which one, just any, and then you make sure if you run it again, you get the same results. Okay, into the train function from Carrot, we're going to feed in now the columns of the train data set, which are our predictors. Then we're using our response variable. Then we specify which algorithm we want to train. I am going to use RF, so Random Forest now. You can also play with the data later on and see if you can make better predictions if you're using another algorithm. And also random forest is not the fastest, so maybe if you want to use more data, it might also be worth trying another algorithm if the speed might be a priority or might be a limiting factor. Then we're going to do a cross-validation just to get a first internal error estimate of the model, and I include the importance is true, which allows us that for the random forest algorithm, we get an idea about which bands are important for the model, so which bands are used by the model in or are indicated by the model that they're most important to split the data into the different land cover classes. Okay, and this time it's quite normal that it takes a while. So we already reduced our data set to only, I don't know how much it was, maybe 4,000 training points. If you think about the spatial prediction competition where we have 9 million training data points, I think that's not going to run on any of our computers here. So also there you might think about reducing the number of training data points, especially if you want to finish until Friday. Okay, mine is finished. Are your models finished as well? Okay. Okay, let's have a first impression of what we just did. So when we look at just a print of the model, we see we trained a random forest model. We used 3,419 training samples. We had 10 predictor variables, and there were actually 8 classes that we aimed at distinguishing, and it just lists here all the different classes that were included in our training data set. It then said that we performed a tenfold cross-validation, and then we get an idea from that cross-validation how good our model is. And yesterday, if you remember, there was only one line in my model output, and it was one line because I suppressed the model tuning. Model tuning is something that you usually need to do for most machine learning algorithms, because there are usually some hyperparameters that you need to tune, so you need to see which settings of these parameters are most useful or perform best for your data set. So there are no universal rules of what you need to do here, but you usually need to tune that for each new data set that you have. And for random forest, the tuning parameter that we have is called mtry. And mtry is actually, or let's start like this. So random forest is based on, in this case, classification trees. And so the by growing the tree, they made certain splits based on our variables. But at each split of the tree, there are not all of our predictor variables presented to the algorithm, but the algorithm randomly selects only a certain number of predictor variables. And now it is a question how many predictor variables the algorithm randomly should select at each split of the tree. And this is our tuning parameter mtry. And what we did here is, because we didn't specify anything special in the train command, and per default it carried tests for 3 different settings of the tuning parameters. So we tested here for 2, 6, and 10. So we tested for the setting that at each split of the tree, 2 variables are randomly selected, and then the random forest algorithm looks which variable in this split is most useful to distinguish between the classes. And then it tested for 6. So it tested, it randomly selected 6 predictor variables at each split and 10. So actually it presented, with 10, it presented all predictor variables to the model at each split of the tree. But what we can see here, if you have a look at the accuracy or at the kappa value, there's not really much of a change. So random forest is usually quite robust to changes in the mtry value. That changes a lot with other algorithms. So there are other algorithms that are much more sensitive to the model tuning, so you really need to take care. But most often for random forest, it's not really that much of a change regardless which mTRI value you choose. So funny enough, so for my studies, whatever I do, it's always mTRI 2. Don't know why, but it's always 2. So sometimes I don't even go into model tuning because I know it will be 2. But yeah, usually, especially if you have a data set that allows you to tune the values, you should go into model tuning. But of course, you need to keep in mind that it takes more time if you do model tuning because it tests the different tuning values for each split for each of our folds in a cross-validation. So we increased the number of models that were tuned during cross-validation by tuning for 3 different values of mTRI. Okay, so we get as a default for classification models, what we get from Caret is the accuracy and the kappa value. And there's not that much of difference here, but always you need to keep in mind that the accuracy is a quite dangerous measure because the accuracy just gives us a percentage of training samples that were correctly classified by the algorithm. But if you think that we might have some classes that are quite small, so there are not many training pixels included in the data set, there's a risk that we get a very high accuracy, but the high accuracy only results from the ability of the model to predict on the majority class. But the algorithm might be completely unable to make predictions for the small classes. That's why in most cases a kappa index is a better measure because it accounts for the frequency of the training points. But yeah, we see generally 0.99, so very high ability of the model to separate our classes. And just to show you the default plot output, when you plot machine learning model, you get an overview about how the tuning or the results of the tuning differed. So we see here on the x-axis the number of randomly selected predictors. So this is mTRI, and we tested for mTRI 2, 6, and 10. And we see the performance here as a line. And you might get the impression from that plot that the model that uses mTRI of 6 didn't perform well at all because it's much lower than the other 2 settings. But if you actually have a look at the scale of the y-axis, where the accuracy just ranges between 0.9925 and 0.9940, so there is nearly no difference at all, although from that plot you might get the impression that there is a large difference in the performance, but always have a look at the scale of the y-axis if you want to judge the performance. Okay, the second interesting thing that we can plot from the model is the variable importance. And what's nice about classification models is that we can actually get the importance for each class separately. So we see here the different predictor variables, and the longer the lines here on the x-axis are, the more important the variable was to distinguish the respective class from the other classes. So if you have a look on the gauze, for example, it's not surprising that the yellowness was the most important variable to make a split between gauze and other land cover classes. And is there something else that is noticeable? I think that's the most most important point where we can really see that it makes a lot of sense that the yellowness was the most important variable to distinguish gauze from the other classes. One last step is missing, and this is a spatial prediction, because in the end we want to create a nice map of the land cover. And as I said yesterday, that's pretty easy, so we just need the predict function. And in the predict function, we feed in our raster stack. The raster stack includes all our predictor variables that we used in the model training, but in a spatially continuous way. So we have the raster representation and not just the values based on our polygons. And we feed in the model that tells us what to do with this data. So we're going to predict. And then we're going to plot the results, and I chose some colors that I thought might make sense. I hope Tim is not going to blame me for my choice of colors. Okay, and this is my result for the land cover classification. And if we compare this with our impression from the true color composite on the first sight, it makes quite much sense. So we definitely have a clear separability from water from the other land cover classes. And we remember that we had a lot of gorse that we have seen in the yellow color here on the slopes, some urban parts here in the left in the left corner of the image, and then we had some grasslands and forestry on the peninsula. So with this prediction, we could now go into a visual interpretation, or especially validation, because often it makes sense that we first have a look at the image and we see if things went right, or if things considerably went wrong. Like yesterday, we've seen that on the land cover classification that was posted on Stack Overflow, someone used the coordinates, and when you print the results here or plot the results, you can directly see if there are some major problems with the model. So usually you really see them quite well if you have a look at the prediction and compare what you get by your impression of or your knowledge about what makes sense in these areas. But of course, we always, or in most cases, or we don't want to have the map, but we also want, and we definitely need a statistical indication about the model performance. And now we can come back to our test data. You remember we split our data set into training data and test data in the beginning, and I said we put our test data to the side and we're not going to use them in the model training. And what we're going to do now, we're using the model and make predictions for the test data, because then we have the chance that we can really compare what the model output was with the test data, where we know which land cover class it belongs to. Do you see a problem with this approach? Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So this is when we go back to, can I go back here to our polygon data set somewhere? Maybe I do it again. Where was it? Ah, yeah, okay, nehmen wir mal den. If I look back here, so what we did, we extracted the raster information for our polygons, but then we randomly split our data into training data and test data, which means that our test data contain the pixels from the same polygons that we used for the model training. We didn't use exactly the same pixels, but we used neighboring pixels, because we split the pixels that we had in one polygon into training and test. So it's very likely that we get a high performance just because we're predicting on neighboring pixels. So what would have been better? It would have been better if we had complete polygons that we would held back. So for example, if we had another water polygon in this area, or this area. So we compare the model to test data that are completely, or as most as possible, independent from the data that we used for model training. But the aim is here to just go through the basic workflow, but it's very important that you keep that in mind, because you see you can create nice maps with that, but don't trust the statistics too much if you, especially if, or always think when you have spatial temporal models, you always need to think about which way of validation makes most sense. So if you want to predict beyond these polygons, you definitely need new polygons to make or to validate the model. So it would have been better if I split my data by leaving all pixels from one polygon out. Okay, but We're still going to use that now and predict on our test data. And what we can do is we can have a look at a contingency table and see how our predictions differ from the actual values that we assigned as ground truth data. So what we see here in the diagonal is all the data points that are correctly classified. So they are, for example, here in the first column, first row, we have 453 data points that had the land cover class bear, and they were also classified as bear by the model correctly. But we see here that we had some points that were urban in our training test data set, but they were predicted by the model as bear. So there is a bit of confusion between bear and urban. And if you look at the other classes, we see that there's also a bit of confusion here with the land cover sand. So between sand, urban, and bear, we have a little bit of confusion, but in general, very high performance. But and here I have a look at the final note, which is important in that context. It's not very surprising that we get a high performance here because, as we said, we used the same polygons for model training and model testing. And this is basically, this is a basic workflow of how to train and how to predict a spatial prediction model. And with a look at the time, we have like 15 minutes left. So I think it doesn't make much sense that we go into the second case study. But still, I want to point out on that second case study. So if you have some free time in the next days, maybe you want to go through that second case study, because here we really pick up the danger of how the problem of having not independent test data can affect the model performance. And it shows that we really have the need for a spatial cross-validation so that we can get objective error estimates. So keep that in mind. So if you have some time, I would recommend having a look at that. Or definitely if you want to go into spatial or spatial-temporal models, definitely have a look at that. That's all from my side so far, I think. Are there any questions from you? So I know that some of you have your own data sets with you and you want to try machine learning with your data sets. We don't have enough time to do it now, but I'm here for the rest of the week. So if you have questions concerning your data sets, just find me and we can have a look if we can solve some problems there. Okay, the question was if I have experiences with other algorithms and not just the random forest algorithm. And I usually, when I train a model, I usually try at least three different algorithms. Sometimes, especially if I do regression models, I sometimes use neural networks or support vector machines. But we also tried Kubist models sometimes, or generalized boosted regression models. But my impression is that in most cases, it's a suitability of the predictor variables that decides whether we have success in our model or not. So if you have strong predictor variables, it doesn't matter which algorithm you use. You always get good results, which are more or less comparable. So it changes a bit between the algorithms, but not in a systematical way. So if one algorithm works better for this data set, that doesn't mean that it works better for the other data set as well. So there's not really the one algorithm that you can always recommend for such data sets. And if your predictor variables are not really useful, then it doesn't matter again, because you can't make good predictions so usually it's a predictor variables which limits the performance of the models. Okay, if there are no further questions, I think we are a few minutes ahead, but I think that doesn't matter. We have, maybe, I don't know if 14 minutes are enough. The problem is we need to go to the other data set because this data set is not suitable because some classes just have one polygon. So we can't make spatial cross-validation here, but so I can just give you a basic idea about how this works again with this data set. So what we have here in the second example that I recommend that you have a look on that maybe later on is, and actually this data set is quite similar to the spatial prediction competition, because what we have here on this field, which is called the Cook Farm, are several points where there are data loggers, and at each data logger was soil moisture measured. But not only once, but for a long time, so for usually several years with a spatial resolution of one day or so. And when we just have a look at a short period of that time series, and we have a look on how the different stations differ. So we see here in the different lines, they are all different data loggers from that field. So we see that we have differences here for each data logger. And the idea is now for the spatial cross-validation that we leave, that we're not going to split this data randomly, but we leave certain, in this case, you want to call it maybe certain lines, so you want to leave the time series of certain data loggers out so that you can see if the model makes sense if you predict beyond the data loggers that you used for model training. And we can maybe very quickly go through that if I find. Second. So I'm going to reduce the time series now to an amount of data that are acceptable in the time we need for the model training. And what I do here again is I define my predictors. And first I'm going to train a random forest model in a random way. And I'm not going to do that now because the time is definitely not enough to train a model now. But if you have a look on the model performance, what we get here is, where is it? So in that case, when I trained a model with a random cross-validation, I got a R-squared of 0.97, so very, very high performance. But if I did it in, I call it target-oriented way, so I left the time series of data loggers out, and I run a model again by this target-oriented cross-validation, I only get a R-squared of 0.23 in this data set, which is considerably lower. And all you need to do for doing this leaf location out cross-validation, you just need to redefine the IDs for the or the folds for the cross-validation here. And you can do that with a create spacetime folds function, where you can redefine or define how you split your data into, for example, 10 folds. By, in this case, the source ID, because the source ID is the ID of the data loggers. And if I have the ID, I can make sure that I always leave certain IDs out. And what is quite, what I want to make sure is that, so we get a very low R squared value here if we look at the target-oriented performance, and usually that's it. So we stop here and we say, okay, it's low, so it's not really working. But I want to make clear that there is actually a way to increase the model performance. And this is that we make sure that we exclude all variables that cannot be interpreted by the algorithm in a meaningful way. So yesterday, that was, for example, the coordinates in that land cover classification example that caused a good random performance, but then the model completely failed in a target-oriented performance. So what I'm doing here is I'm running the forward feature selection, where the algorithm really looks for each or for the combinations of variables, which variables lead to the lowest leaf location out error, and it then excludes all those variables that really cannot make any or cannot reduce the error in space, because they either really have no spatial meaning or because they cannot interpret it by the algorithm in a meaningful way. And if we do that, we can also see here in this example that we could increase the R squared from, I don't know, what did we have before, 0.23, and by only using selected variables, we could increase the R squared to 0.36, and we're only going to use four variables to do this, which also makes the model more robust, because usually you should prefer the smaller models, so those models that are not or don't include all those variables that have no meaning at all. So by selecting the variables that make sense in view to spatial mapping, you create a more robust model, and you create a model that has a higher performance in view to spatial mapping. So that's the basic workflow for the spatial cross-validation and variable selection. We can see also here, not as clear as we see yesterday, where we had the very clear linear patterns, but also here I used the coordinates just to show how they might work as predictor variables, and we see here a linear feature in our predicted soil moisture map. And when or after the variable selection, where of course the coordinates are excluded from the model, we don't have that feature anymore, because this feature is usually, so that's really a sign, so coordinates, that's in such a model setting, that's not a predictor variable, so it cannot make sense in view to, not on that scale, it cannot make sense to make predictions beyond the locations. Okay, any further questions? Okay, if not, then thank you for your attention, and if you have more questions concerning your data sets, you'll find me somewhere around here.